Good afternoon. In today's class, we will be seeing the last topic of Unit 4, which is congestion and quality of service. In the previous class, we have seen TCP and the TCP header and all the other topics related to TCP. Now, I am not covering two topics with respect to TCP, which is flow control and error control. So these two topics we have already seen in data link layer, which is, I believe, Unit 2. And in a flow control, we have seen the different protocols, stop and wait, go back in, etc. So in the case of TCP, it will be using flow control with respect to sliding window. And error control will be will be similar. That is, we will be using checksum, etc. In the case of error control with TCP. So as we know, TCP has both the flow control and error control mechanism. And you can refer to these two topics with respect to data link layer and with respect to TCP and compare both of them by yourself. So now, today I'll be starting congestion and quality of service. And in this topic also, in Unit 3, we have already seen congestion and the two algorithms, which is token bucket and leaky bucket. So we'll be again skipping those. You can refer to the earlier lectures of Unit 3. I believe this topic, congestion, is in the video of fragmentation and congestion. The lecture name is fragmentation and congestion. And you can refer to some part of this topic in Unit 3. So now we will begin whatever left. I'll just give a brief introduction of congestion. Data traffic and what is bandwidth, jitter, delay, etc., all of these terms. And after that, I'll be directly taking the topic quality of service and quality of service improving techniques. So today we will be concluding Unit 4 with these two topics. As we have already seen, congestion control, the first topic we have is data traffic. And this topic also we have studied in Unit 3. So the main focus of congestion control and quality of service is data traffic. Congestion control and the quality of service, the two topics that we have in the last part of Unit 4, that is these two, are the means of improving, are basically related together. And they are the techniques to prevent or eliminate congestion and also improve the quality of service in the network. So for that, first and foremost, we have to understand this term, data traffic. So now what is data traffic? Is basically traffic descriptors. We are qualitative values that we use to represent a data flow. So now basically, whenever we are talking about this traffic descriptors, we have the data rate. And after data rate, we have the in data rate, we have average data rate, peak data rate, then the burst size and the bandwidth. So in congestion control, we try to avoid traffic congestion. And in quality of service, we try to create an appropriate environment for the traffic. So before talking about these two terms, we will understand data traffic. So as I said, we have four terms over here. First is the average data rate. Then we have peak data rate, maximum burst size, and then the effective bandwidth. So effective bandwidth is written here. So these are the four terms that we need to understand for the data traffic. So average data rate is basically the number of bits sent during a period of time. And this topic I've already explained in detail in the Unit 3. You can even refer to that lecture. So I'll just write the formula over here. So average data rate is equal to amount of data by time. So this is with respect to average data rate, and it is very useful characteristic of traffic because it indicates the average bandwidth needed by the traffic. So if we know what is the bandwidth we need, then we can get the average. Then it is very useful because it will let us know what is the bandwidth that is needed. Then the peak data rate defines the maximum data rate. So peak, as we know, is the maximum data rate of the traffic. So basically, this over here, at this point in time, the maximum amount of data was being transferred. So that is the maximum data rate of a traffic. And it is very important because it indicates the peak bandwidth that the network needs for traffic to pass through. So with respect to peak data rate, we get to know the highest amount of bandwidth that we can get. then the maximum burst size is basically, we know what is the peak data rate, right? It is important in the case of a network. Now, the maximum burst size basically refers to the maximum length of time. So this time duration that we have for the peak data rate or peak data to be transferred is known as the maximum burst size. So we can define it as the maximum length of time the traffic is generated at the peak rate. So this is the maximum burst size. And lastly, we have the effective bandwidth. Effective bandwidth is the bandwidth that the network needs to allocate for the flow of traffic. So suppose we are supposed to send some data in a network, then what is the bandwidth that is needed to send the data or the traffic flow is the effective bandwidth. So effective bandwidth is basically a function of three values. So for effective bandwidth, we need these three values: average data rate, peak data rate, and maximum burst size. So the calculation with respect to these three, so the calculation is actually complex, but with respect to these three will give us the effective bandwidth. Now we have the next traffic profiles. Now what is basically a traffic profile is, a data flow can have different kind of traffic profiles. So data flow, whenever the data is traveling in a network, then the data may have constant, it can travel at a constant speed, that is constant bit rate. Then it can travel at variable speed, variable bit rate, and it can also be bursty. Now, constant, by the term itself, we are understanding that it is a fixed rate. The traffic model has a data rate that does not change. So as you can see, it is traveling at a constant speed. So if the data is traveling at, suppose, 100 kbps, then for the entire duration of the data transfer, it will travel at this same speed. So in this type of flow, the average data rate and the peak data rate are the same. So what will happen? Average, as you can see, there is no high or low at this point. So the average data rate and the peak data rate will remain the same. And the concept of maximum burst size, I'll just mention it as MBS, maximum burst size, is not applicable. And this type of traffic is very easy for the network to handle since it is predictable. The network knows in advance how much bandwidth to allocate for this type of flow. Now, next we have the variable bit rate. Now, what is variable bit rate? The rate of data flow changes in time. So here, as you can see, it is varying or being different with respect to different time. And with the changes, smooth instead of sudden and sharp. So it is not smooth, and suddenly it may increase and then it may decrease. So in this type of flow, the average data rate and peak data rate. So the average data rate from the previous diagram, we can see that it is the entire, we take it as an average value, while the peak data rate is over here in this case. And we will also have the maximum burst size. So maximum burst size is usually a small value. And this type of traffic is difficult to handle compared to this constant bit rate traffic. But it normally does not need to be reshaped. Now, what does that mean? We will see it later. Now, the next is bursty. So in the bursty data category, the data rate changes suddenly in a very short time. So you can see that over here, it may jump from zero. So here we have a high speed. Then it is going to zero for a few amount of time. Then the speed is slowly increasing. So here, or it may also remain at this value. So you can see it is remaining at this value or at this bit rate for some amount of time. So the average bit rate and the peak rate are very different. So you can see the average data rate will be very different with respect to peak data rate, which is this one. And the maximum burst size is also significant, because we know here the maximum burst size will be this one, and this entire traffic won't have any maximum burst size. So this is the most difficult type of traffic for a network to handle, because the profile is very unpredictable. So here we may not know when the speed will increase and when the speed will decrease. So to handle this type of traffic, the network normally needs to reshape by using some techniques. And bursty traffic, so this kind of traffic is the main cause of congestion in the network. So because of this, we have congestion. So if it is traveling at constant bit rate, very less amount of chance to have congestion. At this time, we may have some kind of congestion when the data rate increases, but this is the main cause for congestion in the network. Now we have the congestion. What do you mean by congestion? So congestion in a network may occur if the load on the network, the number of packets sent to the network, is greater than the capacity of the network. So the total number of packets we are sending on the network is greater than the capacity. That is the number of packets the network can handle. So suppose this network from A to B can handle 10 packets in a second. So 10 packets per second. So this is not the general way we describe the traffic or the packet that is being traveling. But here, let's just take a general idea. So suppose if there are 10 packets traveling per second, and A wants to send 15 packets. We know that the network can only handle 10 packets. So in this case, we will have congestion. Now, congestion is the term that is, if the capacity of the network is smaller than the number of packets being sent. Now, what is congestion control? It refers to the mechanisms and techniques to control the congestion and keep the load below the capacity. Now, the question is why there is a congestion on a network. So congestion happens in any system that is waiting or that is involving some amount of wait time. So for example, congestion happens on the highway. So if you are taking an example of road traffic, congestion happens on the highway also because there might be some accident during rush hour, or there might be a blockage during rush hour, then that may also cause congestion. Okay. So now with respect to this, we will see an example. So congestion in a network or inter-network occurs because routers and switches have queues. So each router and a switch, that is the devices which are connecting two different systems, will have queues and buffers that hold the packets before and after processing. So a router, for example, will have an input queue and output queue for each interface. So this router, suppose it has three interfaces, then it will have for each interface one input queue and one output queue. So when a packet arrives at the incoming interface, that is when it is the input, it undergoes three steps. What is the first step? The packet is put at the end of the input queue while waiting to be checked. And what happens after that? The processing module of the router removes the packet from the input queue. And once it reaches the front of the queue and uses its routing table, so first, the packet will reach the router. So here it will wait at the input queue. After that, the second step is it will wait for its turn. And once it gets its turn, it will check its routing table. And it will, once it checks its routing table, it will compare its destination address to the routing table and find the route. So here it has arrived. First step, arrived and waiting. Then second step is processed and finding the route. Now after that, the third step is the packet is put in the appropriate output queue and waits its turn to be sent. So here what it will happen, once it has come input, it has been processed. Now it will go to the output queue. Here it is in the input queue, first step. And now it will go to the output queue and wait to be sent. That is, the router needs to send it in to the appropriate route. So now here, there are two issues. So first, if the rate of the packet arrival is higher than the packet processing rate, the input queue becomes longer and longer. So what will happen to the input queue? If the rate of packet arrival is higher than the processing rate. So basically, here, in the case of arrival, when the packet is arriving, suppose there are 10 packets arriving, and the processing is, it is doing, once 10 packets are arriving, it is only processing two of them. Again, 10 packets are arriving, and it has processed by now only four. So in that case, what will happen is, there will be a congestion at the input queue, right? And also, the departure rate, so if the packet departure rate is less than the packet processing rate. So now, suppose, It is in the case of input queue, the first issue. The second issue is now the packets have been processed at a good rate, but the departure is taking time. The router is taking time to send it to its destined route. Then the output queue will become longer, right? So if the processing is done quickly and the packets are coming to the output queue, but output queue is not doing the processing, then this will take time. So these are the two issues that we have. Now we have the next, which is we are seeing two graphs. So congestion control involves two factors that measure the performance of a network. So that is, we have to know two terms to understand about congestion control. First is the delay and second is the throughput. These are the two important terms that need to be mentioned in any answer of congestion control. So with respect to these two graphs, it shows the two performance measures as a function of load. Okay, so with respect to load, we will be seeing what is delay, and with respect to the same load, we will be seeing the throughput also. So first and foremost, when the load is much less than the capacity of the network, then in that case, the delay is minimum. So suppose we are sending very few packets and the capacity is more than that, then there will be very less delay, right? Because the processing is being done quickly since there are few packets. So this minimum delay is composed of propagation delay and processing delay. So in this delay, we will have two terms, which will be propagation delay, and secondly, we have the processing delay. So both of these will be negligible. However, when the load reaches the network capacity and the delay increases sharply, then we now need to add waiting time in the queue. Now there will be another thing over here, that is when the load has reached, that is when the capacity has reached the highest point, then there will be another thing that we need to add, which is waiting time. Waiting time in the queue for all routers in the path. So the delay becomes infinite in this case. So when the waiting time increases, the delay will become infinite. And when the load is greater than the capacity. Now, when the load will become greater than the capacity, the waiting time will increase. So in that case, delay will have a negative effect on the load and it will cause a congestion. So you can see that when here the load is less, this is the no congestion area. But when the load increases very high with respect to the capacity, then it will cause a congestion. So when a packet is delayed, the source not receiving the acknowledgement retransmits the packet, which makes the delay or the congestion worse. So we have already seen in between senders and receivers, once a packet is sent, the sender needs to have an acknowledgement. But suppose if that acknowledgement is not received, again it will retransmit the packet, and this will even more cause congestion in that network. Now we will see the next thing, which is throughput. So throughput, we have already seen in the earlier topics, that is the number of bits passing through a point in a second. So first, let me write the definition. Number of bits passing through a point in a second. So now we can extend this definition from bits to packets. So instead of bits, since we are talking about the transport layer and the network layer, we will just remove these bits to packets. Now, and from this point, we are not talking about a point now, right? We are talking about network. So number of packets passing through a network in a second. Now, the throughput is basically in a network as the number of packets passing through the network in a unit amount of time. So this we are changing to unit time. So now we can define the throughput as the number of packets passing through a network in a unit amount of time. Now when the load is below the capacity of the network, so as you can see, load and the capacity is this one. When the load is less than the capacity, there is no congestion. Okay, the same way here, when the load is less than the capacity, there is no congestion. The yellow part is the no congestion area, but the throughput increases proportionally with the load. So the throughput should remain constant after the load reaches the capacity. But what will happen is, once the capacity has increased, the throughput will keep on declining sharply or decreasing very sharply. So the reason is that discarding of packets by the router. So when the load exceeds the capacity, the queues which we have already seen in the previous slide will become full. And what will the routers do if the queues are full? The routers have to discard some packets. So discarding packets does not reduce the number of packets in the network. Why? Because the source will keep on retransmitting the packets. So even if you discard the packet, source won't get an acknowledgement, and again it will retransmit the packets using the timeout mechanism. So we know that it will have a timer. So when the packets do not reach the destination, so this concept, if you refer it back with respect to the protocols, the flow control protocols, then you will have a good understanding of the same. So these are the two important performance measures, delay and throughput, and these are the graphs with the same. Now we will see the next topic, which is congestion control. So congestion control refers to techniques and mechanisms that can either prevent congestion before it happens or remove congestion after it has happened. In general, we can divide congestion control mechanisms into two categories: open loop congestion control, which is preventing the congestion before it happens, and closed loop congestion control, that is removal of the congestion. Now, with respect to this, we have seen the open loop and the closed loop congestion control mechanisms in unit 3 only. Here we will see the techniques that we are using with respect to the closed loop. So closed loop is basically removing the congestion or trying to decrease the congestion after it is happening. But first, let's see an overview of this open loop congestion control policy. What is this? That is, open loop is basically we are preventing the congestion before it happens. So in these mechanisms, congestion control is handled by either the source or the destination. Now here we will see for each of them briefly. So first is retransmission policy. So retransmission is usually unavoidable. That is, if the source did not receive the acknowledgement, it will retransmit. And if the sender feels that a sent packet is lost or corrupted, the packet needs to be retransmitted. So retransmission in general may increase congestion in the network. So now, what is the retransmission policy that we are using to prevent congestion? We are making sure that there are retransmission timers to optimize efficiency. And at this, so basically before retransmitting, we have some set of timers which will make sure that we are not retransmitting unnecessarily and not causing congestion in the network. Next is the window policy. The type of window at the sender may also affect congestion. So we know that selective repeat window is better than the go back end window. So these are the protocols that we have seen in flow control. So we know that selective repeat is better than go back end. So in this case, the go back end window, when the timer for a packet times out, several packets may be resent, although some may have arrived safe and sound at the receiver. So this duplication may make the congestion worse. So on the other hand, we know that the selective repeat window, what will happen in the case of selective repeat window? Selectively, it will repeat the packets that have been lost or corrupted. So that is the window policy. It is always better to use the selective repeat protocol in the case selective repeat windows or the protocols in the case of a sender, because what it will do is it will not transfer all the packets together that have been lost or corrupted. Selectively, it will transfer the packets. So this is with respect to window policy. Now we have the acknowledgement policy. That is, acknowledgement policy imposed by the receiver may also affect congestion. So if the receiver does not acknowledge every packet it receives, it may slow down the sender and help prevent congestion. So basically, what is happening is, if the receiver is not acknowledging every packet, in that case, what will happen? So suppose if the sender is sending 4 packets, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and the receiver wants to reply to all the 4 with one acknowledgement only, then the sender will keep on waiting. And if suppose the timer times out, again, it will reset. So in this case, what is better is basically the receiver needs to either acknowledge all the, once the packet has arrived, it needs to acknowledge for packet one, then packet two and three and four. Or what we can do is basically the receiver may send an acknowledgement only if it has a packet to be sent or a special timer expires. And also another method is receiver may decide to acknowledge only n packets at a time. So before the communication or the data is being sent, what the receiver will do is receiver will inform the sender that I will acknowledge n number of packets at a time. So in that case, the sender will know that it will acknowledge 4 or 5 packets at a time, and it will send 5 packets and not wait for a long amount of time or resend it packets again. So in this case, we need to know that the acknowledgements are also a part of the load in a network. So sending fewer acknowledgements means imposing less load on the network. So when we are talking about the load in the previous graph, we know that sending packets is included in the load, but acknowledgement is also some kind of data or traffic that is data which is being sent on the network, which may also cause traffic. So if you decrease the number of acknowledgements, then there will be less amount of traffic. Then we have the discarding policy. So now what is discarding? We know that whenever the packets are, whenever the queues are full or routers have received duplicated packets, then they will discard it. Now, what is the discarding policy we need to have to prevent congestion? So a good discarding policy by the routers that may prevent congestion at the same time do not harm the integrity. That is, it may it will send all the packets at the same time is. So for example, in audio transmission, the policy is to discard the less sensitive packets when congestion is likely to happen. So what it will do is, in the case of audio transmission, is have the less sensitive packets, that is the packets which are not important, to be discarded, so that even if there is congestion, it may decrease. Now, the lastly, we have the admission policy. An admission policy is basically a quality of service mechanism which will prevent congestion in virtual circuit networks. So we know that there are two kinds of networks. One is packet circuit and the other is virtual circuit. So in virtual circuit networks, this type of policy is applicable for congestion control. So next we will be seeing the closed loop congestion control. So these topics we will see with the help of a diagram. Now, what is closed loop congestion control? That is, after the congestion has happened, it will try to decrease the effects of that congestion. So first is the back pressure method for alleviating. Alleviating is basically decreasing congestion. So this technique refers to a congestion control mechanism in which a congested node stops receiving data from the immediate upstream node. So this may cause the upstream node. Upstream is basically the nodes before that congested node. So what it will do is it will stop or reject the data from the earlier node. In that case, what will happen is back pressure is a node-to-node congestion control that starts with the node and propagates in the opposite direction of the data flow to the source. So suppose if these four are routed and there is congestion at the third router, then it will apply back pressure. That is, it will ask the router 2 to stop sending the data. Then router 2 will pass on the message to router 1. And then the source will also get the same thing. So basically, from the router to from the immediate neighbor till the source, it will apply back pressure saying that I have congestion and I cannot receive more data. Back pressure can be applied only to the virtual circuit networks in which each node knows the upstream node from which a flow of data is coming. So in the case of virtual circuit networks, the router knows which is the upstream flow of data, that is from where the data is coming, and then it will inform that I am unable to process the packets that I am receiving, so please stop the data flow through my network. Okay. So basically here it will perform back pressure and in the opposite direction. So if the data flow is in this direction, this is the arrow, for the data flow, then in the opposite direction, back pressure is applied. So node 3 over here has more input data than it can handle. In that case, it will drop some packets in the input buffer and informs this node to slow down. Node 2 will be congested because of this, and it will inform node 1, and node 1 will inform the source of the data to slow down. So this basically decreases some congestion, and it performs this back pressure technique. Now we have the next closed loop congestion control, which is choke packet. Now a choke packet is basically a packet sent by a node to the source. So here we are seeing that a packet is being sent from the congested node to the source, saying that I have congestion, that is to inform the source about the congestion. So the difference between back pressure and the choke packet method is, in back pressure, the warning is from one node to the another, and here the warning will directly reach the source. So that is the difference. And the intermediate nodes through which the packet has traveled are not warned. So here, intermediate nodes, that is node 1 and node 2, are not being warned, and we are only informing the source node. So this is with respect to choke packet. Next, we have two other types of closed loop condition control. One is implicit signaling. Implicit signaling and explicit signaling. Now, what is implicit signaling? In the case of implicit signaling, there is no communication between the congested node and the source. The source guesses, makes a guess that there is a congestion somewhere in the network from looking at some other symptoms. Suppose when a source sends several packets and there is no acknowledgement for a while, then what will the source assume? It will assume that there is some kind of congestion in the network, and it should delay receiving an acknowledgement. Now, what is explicit signaling? Explicit signaling is basically node experiences congestion by explicitly sending a signal. So it will make sure that it sends a signal to the source. So this is a difference from choke packet. So we know that in the case of choke packet, the node which is having congestion is directly informing by making use of a choke packet. But here it is different from choke packet. That is, in the choke packet method, a separate packet is used for the purpose. And in the explicit signaling method, the signal is included in the packets that carry the data. So here in this case, the signal that it has a congestion, the signal which is the congestion signal, it is included in, it's included in the data packet itself. It is not wasting another packet. It is sending it the signal in the data packet itself. Okay. So these are the other two types of closed loop control, congestion control. Now we have the next thing, which is the quality of service, last topic. Quality of service and improving quality of service. So quality of service also is a topic we have seen in Unit 3. That is, it is an inter-networking issue, and we can define quality of service as something a flow seeks to attain. Okay, so quality of service is basically, suppose we are sending some amount of packets, then the flow control mechanism makes sure that there is some kind of quality standard that it maintains. So with respect to that, we have these flow characteristics. So reliability, delay, jitter, and bandwidth. We know that reliability is a characteristic that a flow needs. That is, lack of reliability means losing packets or acknowledgement, which makes again retransmission. So for that reason, we need to have reliability. Then delay is source to destination delay. So if we are sending data from source to destination, then there is some amount of delay only a network can tolerate. So suppose in the case of telephone networks, we can have we don't need to have large amounts of delay. So suppose if you're asking a question, the other person in the telephone network needs to answer instantly. So we cannot tolerate delay in the case of telephones. But suppose if we have file transfer or email, then if there is some amount of delay, that can be tolerable. So there are different kinds of delays which need to be maintained and different kinds of network. Then jitter is again an important definition, that is the variation delay for packets. For example, there are four packets which are being sent at the times 0, 1, 2, 3, and they are arriving at 20, 21, 22, 23. Then all of them have the same delay. So suppose I have packet 1, packet 2, packet 3, and packet 4. Packet 1 is being sent at 0 time, packet 2 at 1, 2, and 3. They are taking some general example. At the sender side, these are the times they are leaving for the destination. At the destination side, packet 1 is arriving at 20, packet 2 at 21, packet 3 at 22, and packet 4 at 23. Now we know that the difference between all of them is 20. So that is the delay between all of them is 20. But suppose if we have, this may be the case in some, but in some other case, packet 1 will arrive at 21, packet 2 at 22, packet 3 is arriving at 19, and packet 4 is arriving at 24. So if this is the case, in the case of audios, and in the first case, if you are sending on audio or video, it is acceptable. But in this case, it is not acceptable. That is, the delay needs to be same for all the packets. So jitter is basically defined as the variation in the packet delay. So what variation or what difference here in the packet delay, that is jitter. And high jitter, in the case of jitter, we will have two things. One is high jitter and low jitter. High jitter means the difference between delays is large. Low jitter means the difference is very small or the variation is very small. So in the case of multimedia, that is audio and video, if the jitter is high, some action is needed, because for audio and videos, we need to have low jitter. Okay, so this is with respect to jitter. And bandwidth is basically the total number of bits which are being sent per second, that will be the bandwidth. So different applications need different bandwidths. So in video conferencing, we need to send millions of bits per second to refresh. So suppose if I am making a video, then I need to have millions of bits per second to be sent. While in the case of emails, the number of bits may not be million. That is, we may not need the same number of bits. Now the next we have is the last topic over here, the techniques to improve quality of service. So in the earlier last topic, we have defined what is quality of service by using four terms. Now in this section, we will discuss some of the techniques. So these techniques are basically a leaky bucket and token bucket. So first we have scheduling. There are four common methods to improve the quality of service. First is the scheduling, then we have traffic shaping, admission control, and resource reservation. So what do you mean by scheduling is basically packets from different flows arrive at a switch or router for processing, right? So suppose if the source is sending some packets to destination and there is a node in between, which is either a switch or a router, then it may arrive at different flows. So if there are three or four senders sending data to one destination, then each of them will have different flows. So what is the good scheduling technique is, it treats the different flows in different manners. So for that, we have several scheduling techniques to improve the quality of service. Here we are seeing three of them. First is the FIFO queue. In the first in, first out queuing, packets wait in a buffer until the router or switch is ready to process them. If the average arrival rate is higher than the average processing rate, what will happen is the queue will fill up and new packets will be discarded. So, and the FIFO queue is basically the packets which have arrived first will be processed first and departure will happen for those packets. Now the next is so here arrival, it will check whether the queue is full. If not, it will enter the queue and whichever packet has arrived first will be in the processor and it will depart. If the queue is full, yes, then it will discard the packet. This is with respect to the FIFO queue. Now we have the priority queuing. priority queuing is basically packets are assigned, first assigned to a priority class. First, the packets will check, the router will check whether the, what is the priority of that packet. So each priority class has its own queue. So the packets in the highest priority queue are processed first. So there are two types of priority over here. One is the higher priority queue and the lower priority queue. So in the higher priority queue, the packets which are in the this queue are processed first, and these packets which are the lower priority queue are processed later. So what will happen over here, you can see the once the packets arrive, there is a classifier which will check whether it is higher priority or lower priority. If it is a higher priority and if the queue is not full, then it will enter the queue, it will be processed and departed. Then if it is full, if the higher priority queue is full, the packet is discarded. In the case of lower priority, also the same will occur. But what will happen is, once the higher priority queue is empty, then only the lower priority queue will be handled. So this is with respect to priority queue. This priority queue is better for quality of service than the FIFO one, because suppose if we have multimedia, audio and video, then these can reach the destination with less delay. Now, but there is one drawback. If there is continuous higher priority queue flow only, then the packets from this lower priority queue will never have a chance to be processed. So this kind of disadvantage or this thing is known as starvation. That is, only the higher priority queues are being sent and the lower priority queues are not being sent at all. Now, the next is weighted fair queuing. So weighted fair queuing is basically, in this technique, the packets are still assigned to different classes and admitted to different queues. So it is also similar to priority queuing, but there are only, in the case of priority, we had high and low, but here what will happen, it will be based on the weight. And what is this weight? There are higher priority means high weight. Then there is medium weight. Then there is a lower weight also. And the this weighted queues will operate in a round robin fashion. That is, in the case of the system processes packets in each queue in a round robin fashion, with the number of packets selected from each queue based on the weight. For example, in this case, if weights are 3, 2, and 1, and the three packets are processed from the weight 3, and two packets are processed from weight 2, and one packet is processed from weight 1. So if the system does not impose priority on the classes, then what will happen? Suppose if the system does not need the priority concept, then what will happen is it will have all the weights to be equal. So in this way, we will have fair queuing with priority. So here you can see, once the packet has arrived, there are three classifiers. For weight 3, we will have one decision box, whether it is full or empty, the same discarding of packet will occur. Then for weight 2 and weight 1 also. So here what will happen, this is the round robin fashion. This is a turning switch which selects three packets from the first queue, two packets from the second queue, one packet from the third queue. Now what this 3-2-1 is basically, it is the higher priority number also, and also it is assigning three packets in this case also. So this three, the weight is very important. And in this way, the queuing is done in the case of weighted fair queuing. Now the next is the traffic shaping. Traffic shaping is a mechanism to control the amount and the rate of traffic. So what will happen is basically, we have seen the first, what are the data flows, different data flows we have. One is the constant bit rate. Then we have the variable bit rate and the bursty bit rate. In that case, in this traffic shaping, what will happen is, one second, yeah. So the next technique is traffic shaping. Here it is making sure that there is some kind of control on the amount and the data rate of the traffic. Control on two things. First is the amount of the data, and the second is the rate of traffic in the network. So it will make sure of these two things in the case of traffic shaping. So now for this traffic shaping, there are two techniques. One is the leaky bucket and the other is the token bucket mechanism. Now, these two mechanisms, leaky bucket and token bucket, we have already seen within Unit 3. So, I will not be explaining these two topics again. You can just refer to the lecture of fragmentation and congestion in Unit 3. I believe it is lecture number 3.9. Now, we will see the last two mechanisms of quality of service improving. So, here we have seen the scheduling. There are three kinds of scheduling. First is the FIFO scheduling, then we have priority, and then weighted. Traffic shaping is basically leaky bucket and token bucket. Now, what is this resource reservation and admission control? Admission control is basically the mechanism used by the router or switch to accept or reject a flow based on some parameters. So admission, basically, the router will give admission to only those packets which satisfies its parameters. Now, what will be these parameters? The parameters the router will decide on its own. So basically, before a router accepts a flow for processing, it checks the flow specification. Now, what are the flow specifications it has? It may have the flow specification in terms of bandwidth or buffer size or CPU speed. So these are the different kinds of parameter it will have. And based on this, it will give admission to the flow for processing. Now, lastly, what is resource reservation? A flow of data needs resources such as these. It needs bandwidth, buffer, CPU time, etc. So in this case, for improving the quality of service, resources are reserved beforehand only. So these resources or the parameters are reserved already. And depending upon this resource reservation, what we will do is we will try to improve the quality of service. So this is with respect to the techniques to improve quality of service. So with this, this concludes your fourth unit. And in the next class, we will be starting unit 5.